Welcome back, geology fans. Given our repeated generalization that earthquakes don't kill people, buildings kill people, we will focus today on how to make our buildings and structures safer. This is what we call earthquake mitigation. Since buildings tend to fall and kill people, we need to build structures to resist earthquakes. The first big lesson to learn is that unreinforced masonry is asking for trouble. Obviously, there is expense to reinforcements, but when you do an assessment of how much it costs to use reinforcement and find it is at least one order of magnitude less expensive than repairing unreinforced structures from a damaging earthquake, you'll find the logic in reinforcing buildings in earthquake-prone regions. With the cruel reality of economic inequality, we can see that countries like Haiti can sustain some of the largest death tolls in earthquakes due to only being able to afford such unreinforced masonry. So with the brutal economic constraints, reinforcement to a personal homeowner such as yourself means things like fastening the base of your home to the foundation and putting in steel and concrete to add strength. There have been recorded vertical movements from quakes in excess of gravitational acceleration, which can cause a building not fastened down to actually jump off its foundation. And we will get into other types of homeowner protection in a moment. But first, there is an odd exception to reinforcement. As we said, unreinforced masonry is very susceptible to damage, and yet completely unreinforced masonry may help. The Incas of 15th century Peru used dry stone wall construction, and seeing as they're still standing after almost 600 years in a heavy earthquake-prone area of Peru, they obviously have some kind of an advantage over traditional masonry. The stones are so well cut that they fit together like puzzle pieces and can move relative to each other and simply settle back into place when the shaking ends. Now, effective as that is, it is not too helpful to our modern world where we can't simply use dry stone construction. It can be a bit drafty in colder climates, and the Incas never built bridges and overpasses for cars and trucks. Overpasses have long been one of the most sensitive structures to quakes, as they are often placed on thin support structures that can punch through overlying road, have supports fail, or sections of road slip off their supports during shaking. Building overpasses to be flexible and allow greater movement without failure, mainly by widening the support structures and leaving gaps to allow movement between concrete slabs, can save many lives, proportional to the mass of traffic at the time of day the quake hits. I have to admit that when I'm in earthquake-prone areas like California, I have an urge to speed up when going under or over these overpasses, but fortunately, they've actually reinforced most of those these days. But most urban people at any time are in buildings at any time of day, so reinforcement of buildings becomes a prime concern. We mentioned before that resonance, the matching of earthquake wave frequency to the natural frequency of a building, is an issue, and was violently demonstrated in the 1985 Mexico City earthquake. Buildings one or two stories high generally survived in areas of severe shaking, and so did buildings over four stories tall. But buildings between two and four stories tall were demolished. This is the pattern expected from resonance of the building's natural frequency with a seismic wave shaking. To avoid resonance and amplified shaking in general, we have devised two avenues of attack: damp out this resonance directly or try to damp out the waves themselves before coming into the structure. We will investigate these more in a moment, but for some oddball cases, a strange form of resonance we have to look out for is tall towers next to each other which might sway in opposite directions in the same phase and then smash into each other at their tops, but I can find no proven cases of this happening yet, just warnings of its possibility. Most building failure is through a process called pancaking. A weak floor within the building acts as the weakest link and fails, bringing down all above that point. We can build buildings to not have weak levels. I mean, first floor parking garages are so weak and dangerous. But we can also do more to protect buildings. Previously, we pointed out that the substrate, the rock and earth below you, can greatly affect the amount of shaking you feel. The previously mentioned Mexico City earthquake was a bit puzzling in that areas closer to the epicenter had less shaking than the further away downtown area built directly on loose, filled-in lakebed material. We can map out these weak substrate areas and zone for building codes. Areas expected to get worse shaking should have a limit to their height and regulations on their reinforcement building codes. Making buildings that can flex and bend with motion without failure are obviously much better than a stiff, brittle building. There are energy-absorbing metallic structures we can install within a building that bend and absorb and dampen the seismic energy. But these have the disadvantage of having to be replaced after an earthquake exposure as they end up bent and weakened after absorbing most of the stress from an earthquake. Better it to form than your whole building, right? But they can bend enough to leave the building in a different position, which will require some major reconstruction. So it might be even better to reduce the total amount of shaking within the building beforehand. We can allow the waves to enter the base of the building, but just reduce the building's response. A counterweight can be placed at the top of a building to dampen the total building movement during a quake. This falls into the category of seismic damping mechanisms. These are mechanisms that don't reduce the amount of energy entering a building at its base, but reduces the building's response to those vibrations. Some of these, like a counterweight pendulum, are passive and merely respond as the seismic waves reach them. Others are more active, a responsive pendulum, and take readings from the base of the building to actively damp resonance within the building. The other tactic is to reduce the amount of energy coming into the building through its base to start with in what is known as seismic or base isolation. Ancient Persians in the 6th century BCE built buildings with base isolation, which is simply allowing the ground to move below without carrying the buildings above. But with our advanced knowledge, we can do better with contraptions like large rubber springs supporting the bottom of a building with lead cores at their centers. As the building experiences ground movement, the springs help to keep the building more stable than the ground, and the lead core there is key. Lead has a low melting point, and as it gets sheared and stressed by the ground moving and trying to drag the overlying building with it, the lead gets frictionally heated enough to melt. Recall that the most damaging wave is the love wave, but it can't transmit through liquids. S waves are also very damaging and get absorbed by liquids. When the leaden cores of these springs the building is sitting on melt to a liquid, these love and S waves can't transmit up into the building. Or to say it another way, the most damaging seismic waves can't get into a building resting on liquid core springs. Anything we can do to save buildings automatically saves lives. But most of us won't be involved with such big decisions on buildings and should look closer to home. So to come back and complete what the average homeowner should do beyond the previously mentioned fastening of a house to its foundation, the most important points to make are things like properly fastening your water heater to the wall, which can save you a lot of water damage after a quake. Beyond the obvious mitigation of securing your water heater, think what in your house in general could fall if shaken and possibly do damage. And the overall principle here is to fasten or secure looser objects, especially the ones that can do serious damage if they fall. When it comes to the prediction of large earthquakes, the United States has taken a more pragmatic attitude that prediction is seriously uncertain right now. Poor predictions can result in negative societal impacts, and so the best tactic is to recognize places where earthquakes can occur. That's risk identification. Set up detection points that can radio ahead of the damaging seismic waves on their way. Risk monitoring. Predict how large they can get. Intensity prediction. And you know what? Intensity prediction is probably one of the most valuable services we can provide. It results in building regulations to resist that anticipated maximum level of shaking, probably the most effective way to protect lives. It's also important to educate the public about how to recognize and respond to severe earthquakes. Knowing that Southern California is most likely due for an 8-point-plus earthquake relatively soon, the California government instituted the Great California Shakeout, in which seismologists did extensive studies to give this picture of what a Southern California 8-point-plus quake could do to the LA Basin, which is pretty nasty as the waves bounce off the mountains in the area and get amplified. But beyond that, they had all government services participate in a simulated disaster caused by such a quake. School children were instructed on how to protect themselves, which mainly falls under the category of, if you are outdoors, stay outdoors with no overhanging objects. And if you are in a building, get under a protective structure like a table or a bed, and protect from falling objects, including whole fours pancaking above you. In the Great Shakeout, emergency crews and hospitals rehearsed the challenges that will face them with such an event. Families were instructed in preparing an emergency kit and plan. If any of you are former military, you may recognize the principle of preparation for the worst. We are better suited to survive it, and anything less severe. We started this series on earthquakes quoting the famous quip that any place on Earth is like the life of a soldier, consisting of long periods of boredom punctuated by brief moments of terror. Since we can't predict the terror of earthquakes with confidence, the best bet at this time is to find the periodical high-risk areas and then build to resist. California has been good about this, but places like Seattle, where quakes are rarer, and thus a bit more severe, often do not have the risk directly presented to them, and get complacent. Hopefully the recent shocking yet accurate report in the New Yorker about the earthquake, landslide, liquefaction, and tsunami risks of the Pacific Northwest will spurn people and government into action to retrofit their buildings and prepare for the expected disaster. If you live in an earthquake-prone area, stay educated. Know your family and your work emergency plan and evacuation routes. Stay alert, stay prepared, and you will have a major advantage to survive over an unprepared population. But earth terrors abound, and the most competitive earthly terror with earthquakes is volcanic risks. The good news here is that we have much more success, even though it may not be perfect, in predicting volcanoes and reducing their local risk. When we come back next time, we will look into the many ways that volcanoes can kill you before we look into how to predict these tectonic beasts here on Earth Explorations.